the seed of the work lies in largely an academic work, the life and time of Dr. Kadambini Ganguly. Often she is portrayed as the first lady doctor of British colony. It's not true. We must mention Anandi Bai Joshi. She was trained in Pennsylvania and couldn't get her practicing license since she died very early. Kadambini Gangobadhyay, we can say this much. She is the first registered lady physician in Indian subcontinent during the colonial times, that is 1883. And the first thing just in the first question he put for me is, as you started conceiving your project, what did you feel you could or would gain from the collaboration with another firm? So my answer is like this. While working on Dr. Kadambini's life, fortunately, during the material collection of my research, apart from those authentic stuffs like gazetteers, government reports, minutes, proceedings, etc., I found and accumulated a lot of informal materials, now they are called ephemera, and clinical ephemera like old Kobiraji Ayurvedic prescriptions, which looks like basically like horoscope, and other peculiar Kobiraji handbills, mantra, like very critical charm written on a handmade paper like this. I didn't know what to do with this, because so far a formal biography is concerned, these things cannot be incorporated, since they are very informal in nature. They are not time-stamped. They are of very poor quality, written in a poor language, produced in a poor manner. But they themselves are very interesting. So this is Kadambini Ganguly. And what I must mention is, in 1873, her father, Brajokishore Bosu, sent her to Kolkata to study, residing in a boarding. And the boarding was operated by Miss Ackroyd, Miss Anita Ackroyd, who later became Anita Ackroyd Beveridge. And she, along with Kamini Sen or Kamini Rai and other luminaries, then, these are the known photographs. And now, when I started working with this project, and it was a result of discussion with Shubham. He had contributed a lot in it. After the establishment of Calcutta Medical College, it was at the same time Bengali print culture was started evolving. So when medical books came into circulations, the Bottala or the popular print culture started publishing some chat books, and they called these books a medici of medical books on surgery, and these were hilarious. Like the book I have shown here, it's called Drobbogun, the secret power of some materials. This material can be a pigeon's egg, a vulture's feather, and Rudraksh, etc. All these have medical properties. And another thing started, they started portraying the human body, the parts of the body, based on the illustrations of Western textbook, but in a different manner. Like, it is from that kind of chat book of jurisprudence. If someone commits suicide by hanging, how to determine whether it's a suicide or a murder? See, the context is Bengali society, but the lady portrayed here is wearing a gown. These are examples of those chapbooks, and these are the titles. Mushti Jog, it means the final thrust of a medicine. When someone is dying and the doctor or the Kaviraj has nothing to do, then he or she applies something very special, which is a trade secret, like this. Then, whenever I mention Kadambini, everybody says, every book says, she is the fast doctor. How she can be? She is from a village in Borishal called Chandshi. If you were associated with the term Chandshi, it's an indigenous process of treatment. Now it is popular in Kerala also, in Tamil Nadu also, but it is from a village called Chandshi, where outcasts, mainly Chandas, later they were called Namashudras, they were the practitioner of this medicine, and the goddess who bestowed these medicinal skills is Ma Manosha. She is called Bishwakarma. And among these practitioners, there were a substantial amount of medical summons, medicine women, who were revered and feared at the same time. Someone is something like a witch or a dakini. In the truest sense of the term, dakini, dakini means a woman who is wise. That's how the word dakini comes into being, especially in the Tibetan concept. Then, the main question is, how did I interact with other forms? Firstly, it was a scholastic kind of documentary formal biography. Then I shifted from it to an art project. What is that? To write a novel based on these informal documents. I went through the books again and found some mentions of the phenomenal capacities of some dais, midwives. I identified at least three dais who used to be called dais, but they are not dais. The first one is Hotu Pittarankar. She is from Hooghly district, but she opened her toll at Varanasi and teaching the students of Ayurveda from all corners of India. She used to wear a chadar and dressed like a male pandit, and her skill of Ayurveda was phenomenal. And the other two are, one was called Rajurma, mother of Raju, and Jodurma, mother of Jodu. See, we don't know their names. And this Rajurma admitted her son, Raju, to medical college, and he became a very famous surgeon. Now, Rajurma practiced her skills mainly in marginal areas, primarily Bhatra Mohila, we call it in Bengali, those who are those who belong to at least not aristocrat but middle class, and the family has some education. The Bhatralok and Bhatramila terms are very complicated. So Rajurma went from house to house, and In this connection, I should mention, at that point of time, when women restricted in the inner sanctum of the house needed to see a physician, they had no option. They didn't die during childbirth to a large number. If you go through the statistics, most of them died from skin disease because they were shy and couldn't show their disease to other European female doctors or male Kobiraj. In this gap, native, illiterate, obscure physicians like Rajur Ma came into being, and they were terribly active, and they were the only solace to these women who couldn't go to a, even to a European lady doctor or a male Kobiraj. Now, I'll just follow my presentation. This icon, the idol, is called Lajja Gauri. She is called the shameless goddess. You see her posture. This is a representation of a Pottachitra depicting the delivery. And the lady in blue is the Dai, and the lady in yellow is the mother. And these pots are supposed to contain a magical element. If the mother touches the pot, it is believed that her delivery pain will be reduced. This is another representation. Now, this is the anatomy class of Pennsylvania Medical College where Anandibai studied. And in this image, you see the male experts are supervising. But after that, they are doing this by themselves. When it started here in Bengal, the ladies who were college educated or school educated were portrayed like this. Like this. And you see, the main problem was the right part. Because if one lady is educated enough, then she will enslave her husband. These are some advertisements of some native formula recipes. Here also, it's called Bijaya Botika, remedy of all diseases. But in the advertisement, we see an European lady. Primarily, my work is to free the idea of lady doctor from the colonial construct, from the medical college. They were beyond the area and arena of the knowledge practiced in the colonial space of medical colleges. This is, I want to conclude with this image. This is a ban, like Marun Uchaton, the practice of voodoo. I have visited some Dais or midwives. Still, they are competent enough. They are as good as a gynecologist. But they use this till now and they believe in it. Thank you.
Being brought up by the panel and the questions that we were asked. So, let me clarify that This is part of a project which me and Abhik Mukhopadhyay are doing together. And Abhik, so it's like a twin project. Abhik is doing an animation film which is being shown in the program. And along with that, I was supposed to do two things. One is to write this the script and do a graphic novel out of the a novel called Lukthak or the Dog Star by Navarun Bhattacharya. So the screenplay, so the graphic novel in that sense is a broader project than the film, which is a short animation film and part of larger project that Abhik has. So now for now, I will just talk about the work. So this is one of the models that he created for the, along with the artists, for the animation film. So this is just a reference to the, you know, the project that both of us are doing. But I would like to sort of go back to my the person who initiated or gave me the courage to do this project was actually Navarun Bhattacharya, the author, famous, who became really famous with this poem and the book of poems that came out actually quite some time back. But while I was actually, I started conversing with Navarun Bhattacharya around 2010-11 when I was working with, actually Shuman Mukhopadhyay was, this is Shuman Mukhopadhyay's Herbert, which was also an adaptation of Navarun Bhattacharya's Academy Award winning novel. But so when I was working for him and with him for another graphic novel project, which is, and the novel was called Kahal Malshat. So the story goes like this, that after Herbert, Navarun Bhattacharya sort of became extremely popular at the time when he invented these three character prototypes called Patharus, or men who can fly. So there is a mantra that these men have, which is very simple. You can try it out. It is fat, fat, shy, shy. And you have to sort of utter that and you can fly. So these three men, these are basically drunkards and loser, failed poet, one of them. A sort of a variation of Navarun's own sort of rather well-known and celebrated writing. So when Shuman started working on this film project, which is so, Fatarus are a series of short stories, which then culminated into the novel Kangal Malshat. And Shuman was adapting Kangal Malshat, which is an incredibly brave thing to do. So I thought that I could join, you know, this project, and I said that I wanted to do a graphic novel in collaboration with the film, because in a way, Kangal Malshat is an impossible task to adapt to any sort of a linear narrative, because every event, every moment goes into this, there are at least three or two aspects to it. One is that it goes into a different time frame. The other is there are these elaborate sort of critical writing by Navarun. So when I first met Navarun in a book fair, we were doing the recce for the film. I went up out of my nervousness and actually great admiration for him. But I wanted, so I told him that, you know, all your films, only the men fly. There are no women flying. So, and I was really embarrassed having said that. But anyway, he said that, okay, fine. So you are doing a graphic novel, you make women fly. So I took up, so there is this one sex worker in the novel who finally gets wings. And the Fatarus, they actually, in the novel that I did, they have the wings of the grasshoppers, but the woman, she has the wings of the butterfly. All really sort of, none of them are actually birds. So Namarunda, initially told, he was of course very encouraging, but he told me, you know, I don't understand, you know, graphic novel trouble. I don't understand all this. But I think, sir, show me what you want to actually do. Then I showed him various things and he said, but you could actually try out the Kalighat pot style. I said, no, Varunda, I don't want to copy. I want to do something else. And I, since I don't earn my living by, doing graphic novels, and since I never thought it will be published also, so I could do anything, because there wasn't much of a pressure, as it were. So in those conversations, he told me that, have you read Looptop? I also wanted to sort of clarify this, that having grown up in Delhi, I'm not much of an avid reader of Bengali novels and literature. I said, no. So Lopdhok Porishni, and he gifted me a book, and then he said that Lopdhok is actually the one that can be made into a graphic novel. So when I read it, I realized, yes. And it fitted into larger various projects, city-based art projects that I was doing, especially video. In that sense, there is another thing. While I started working and tried to do art projects, initially I was quite skeptical of, I didn't even tell people that I teach film studies in a university, because they thought I was too intellectual and making really dense art projects, which nobody could enter in a way. So it is now, after actually working on this project for 5-6 years, that I have the courage to say, no, it's a research-based art project. And thanks IFA for supporting so many that kind of projects. So this is part of a project that I did with Camp Mumbai. And this is one of the pages of the Kamal Balchand adaptation, War Cry of the Beggars. Initially, I did an English version, but later it was published as in Bangla. So, yes. So, basically, it already had a density of using drawings, taking frames from the film and doing... This is a rough sketch. This is not published. That's how Lopdhok came about. Now, Lopdhok... Just to give you a faint idea about what the plot is about, it's actually a novella about a city without any human characters, right? And so initially Navarun wanted me to do the graphic novel, and then he said, you go and make a film. So I said, Navarun, I can't make a film. So I said I could speak to Abhik, because Abhik was shooting Kamal Manshad. So he said Abhik could also do that. So then that's how it became and as soon as Abhik heard about it, we were actually planning to do a kind of a film shooting the street dogs and do a kind of a gangster narrative with that.
Lopdhok, or the Dog Star, has a very interesting plot in the sense that it begins at the point of an apocalypse, that there is going to be an earthquake and there is going to be the end of the world and so on and so forth. And then the event is that the municipality has decided, the city, and it's Calcutta, and so it is also a science fiction. So Navarun has this very specific kind of a sci-fi style where he would actually mention a particular street, a particular road, a particular street corner. It's very specific. And then it is also, about the other world. So the dogs will be evacuated from the city, and there are these plans that are being done in a very sort of a nonchalant way, in the sense that whether they should be killed or whether, but if you kill all street dogs, there will be too many street dogs lying on the streets, how to clean that, if you do this, if you do that, if you poison them, what do you do? The government body decides that they will take these dogs to a place called Pinjrapol, which is where also the sort of elderly cows are taken, and they will just starve them to death, and it's Pinjrapol, it's like a samsan, so they will sort of perish there and end of things. However, suddenly, the Dog Star up on the sky, sort of, it's serious, it starts sort of blinking far more brightly than it actually does, and things happen. So But Nobarun's this novel, when I started working, I figured out it came far before, when Calcutta was actually going through beautification. So this is an actual sort of an image of a gate that you might find on the eastern side when you come from the airport. This is in the middle of a wilderness, you have a western gate, you know. So the city now has two gates. And while looking up, I also figure out that there is a park where there are seven wonders. It's a slightly improved version of the original because the original is broken and all that. And it's an entertainment park. It's like this, the Colosseum and the Taj Mahal and so on. And this, of course, we all know when we go to the city that we also have what is known as the Chota Ben. So, Chota Ben. So, it is part of this project. And since I have 3 minutes left, so I started working on that kind of, I've been working on the city and city maps and trying to do many things. So, the Dog Star begins like that. There's a city that is asleep. And just to quickly tell you that this, just to about this image, that this is actually the train that you see in the middle is a drawing of the Metropolis, the film 1926 Metropolis. So that's how I began. So this is how it begins, only 7 hours left. And there is a plan to have a clean, so I've been asked, you know, that it says a clean city. And I purposefully, in the novel and also in the film, when I was doing the intertitles, I have used clean state, state as in India. I have done those things, and when they plan this, they begin to receive a message. So this is the thing. So in any case, what I feel and why I think this conversation can go on is that Nobarun's writing is a very, very dense kind of a writing, and it can probably only be sort of adapted into a graphic form given the ways in which you can imagine pages. So it's really dense it is also really, really very visual and oral. These are the descriptions, you know, that this is how it opens, that there is the sound of this, sound of that, but you don't hear the dogs barking. Where have the dogs gone? So I have been borrowing a lot from the couplets which break up the plot. And actually, instead of the incidents, these are the cues to my image, the poems, the couplets. So I had already worked on something like this earlier, and it is from, and these are, you know, especially the 1930s German artists working in the US, the first sort of, it's called a wordless novel actually, or let's say this woodcut style that I thought lend itself to the kind of narrative that Nobarun is producing. So one of the things that I tried to do, instead of, you know, Nobarun is extremely political, and to make that whatever you sort of adapt into, not into some kind of a humanitarian kind of we love dogs kind of a thing, but, you know, the thickness of the political reference, where there's any event has a reference to the Second World War, to the Naxalite movement, to the present, and it's very dense, I thought a particular style is needed to be able to make meaning from that. So I started, of course, doing the sketches, and these are the sketches of my own dogs, so you will always find them sleeping mostly, because that's how I can make sketches of them and thoughts, rough thoughts and so on. And this is one of the lines that he has, that where the dogs went missing, and he said maybe somebody has tied a firecracker to its tail and it has flown off like a rocket. And that's how it came about. The things that what I have done, of course, bringing in my own thought, is not to have dogs which are sexless, you know, genderless. So this is a female dog, and these are all the kind of couplets that are there. The dogs, it's a silent night, the dogs are unaware, then the Cyrus is warning them, and the kind of conversations that you have between the government officials. So, do I have, I'm done? Okay. So, just one line as to, so these are some of the sketches of the characters. So just to sum up that this project then lies at the sort of cross-center of, you know, cross-section of many things. One is it's a very, very dense novel. The other is a kind of a work and research that I've been doing on the city or the various art projects that I've been trying out, including video and graphic forms. The other is the animation film with which this has developed. So in a way, I would say that woodcut and Nobarun's words that, you know, why don't you sort of refer to the Kali Ghat, sort of urged me to go back to the popular and established style in Bengal is the woodcut. And so, but just to tell you that since I am not actually working on wood, but working on paper to bring that kind of an effect, it has become far more difficult, you know, because you are trying to sort of produce a woodcut print, as it were, on paper. So to do that, I think in some ways these the method of doing, I would say, rather than the end product, brings us to this question of confluence of forms. So I'll stop here.
This is something I had been doing for at least 20 years. And I used to work in an archives of Indian music in Delhi, Gurgaon actually. And in 1996, I started a project of measuring the acoustic properties of one space particularly in Orissa called Ranigumpa. But because I was working in full-time in an archives, I didn't have too much time to do anything else, but it was a very important thought in my head that there are many places in India that need to be looked at not as visual objects or as part of history, but as acoustic objects. As what do they contribute in terms of sound? Lots of thoughts about it, but I did not have much time to do anything about it. In 2015, I came to Bangalore. I had retired officially because I was 70 years old. And then I applied for a grant with Nidag House, who is now in Berlin. And the two of us applied for a grant from IFA for me to continue the work. The grant was given in my name, but actually it involves both Nida and Lawrence in conceptualizing some of the things that we have done. And I started doing the project in 2017, I would say, with two sites in mind. One was the Kuthambalam in Thrissur, the temple, and I wanted to do measurements. The selling just in my name was useful because the manager of the Kuthambalam said, Umashankar Mantravadi has, and gave me immediate permission. So one of the few times when my name has, actually I don't use Mantravadi in my name. I just write Umashankar, and like Arundhati has just done, call me Uma. But we were able to do acoustic. See, this acoustic measurements had been in at the borders of many of the things I do. I work in archives, so I'm fairly involved with the kind of performance and music that people have produced, not now but also in the past. The second thing is I am interested in electronics. It was my hobby, and when I started doing things in film, I realized that the equipment that was available at the costs I could afford were not enough, so I started making things like microphones. The third was when I wanted to do acoustic measurements of spaces, I realized that the equipment I wanted was in the tens of thousands of dollars. So there was no way I could get it. So I had to figure out a way of making equipment that I could use. And now, actually, in the last 5 or 6 years, I have a complete kit that I can pack in a suitcase and take. There was one problem when I went to Trissur. Trissur, of course, we drove up, by, so it was not a problem. And the second site I wanted to do was Anuppu, which meant I had to fly to Hyderabad. And part of the equipment was a loudspeaker, which was powered by lithium cells. And the airport in Bangalore quietly removed all the cells. They're expensive, they're not cheap to buy. About 10,000 rupees worth of cells. And I had to buy them again in Hyderabad, they were not good enough. And Anuppu was extremely hot, about 45, 46, and there is no shade at all in that site. And the batteries actually caught fire while we were doing measurements. So after that, I went back to thinking about how I was going. See, this is going to be a problem I'll see all the time when I do measurements. The thing is, it has to be low cost. This loudspeaker I built, it was 3D printed and all that. It's all very nice, but it's heavy, and I can't afford to replace lithium cells every time I go out of town. And so I collaborated with Professor Angelo Farina in Parma as part of my, right from 96. Because it is one of the funny things that happens to me in life. When I joined the archives in 82, it was the year in which the first digital recorder, the PCM F1, was released. It's the month in which it was. The release was the month in which ARC started. So I could sort of emphasize the digital side of preservation right from beginning. And the archives is one of the fully digital spaces with the material going back to the 1910 period. All of it, and we have just done a major project digitizing recordings done by Komal Kothari in Jodhpur. So the thing was, I was an analog sound recorder. I carried an Agra on my shoulder as a filmmaker. But it just happens that when I was getting into an archive, the means for doing digital archives just started opening up. Similarly, when I started doing acoustic measurements in 96, it's also the year in which acoustic measurements got standardized. Now, you see, the acoustic measurements start in around beginning of the 20th century in Boston. Ernest Sabin, the founder of the field. But, you know, people went in, Sabin himself used a tuning fork and his ears to measure reverberation time in spaces, which is not a very satisfactory, you know, I do it and probably get a much shorter reverberation time. My hearing is not that good. And it matters a lot that, you know, even now, actually, there are people who have not yet adapted to a fully modern way of doing these measurements who will use hand claps or use gunshots. Gunshots are, of course, now become impossible. We can't carry it in a flight. You know, it's actually a starter pistol, but you can't carry it with a lot of paper with it. So, when 96, the standards were set, you know, this is what you want to measure, this is the kind of techniques you should use. I was making a microphone called an ambisonic microphone. I called it Brahma because it has four heads. And that microphone promised an easy, simple way of doing the measurements that are needed to meet this requirement. And initially, I was using this loudspeaker with a sine sweep, which still is the best way of doing it, but becoming difficult. So after a lot of discussion with other scholars in the field, and decided to use balloons. Surprisingly, if you take a 30-centimeter balloon and pop it with a needle very precisely over on the top of your head, you can get repeatable measurements. The thing with any of these things is you should be able, if I do something and come back, and somebody else should be able to go and do the same thing and get the same results. Because otherwise it becomes, it isn't science essentially, if it's not repeatable. And if it is not repeatable, what you're saying about it may be very interesting, but you have to trust me. For that I don't need to take equipment, I have good hearing. So I'll go to Rani Gumpa and say, that's wonderful sound. And that's all I will be able to say. I want to be able to say more than say it's a wonderful sound. I want to say something that others can also compare. You know, and the other issue was, I go to Rani Gumpa in Orissa, come back, and a year or two later, I go to another site. What is the comparison between the two? My hearing is not going to help because you don't remember sound the way we remember visually. So I had to have methods for that. That is the other aspect that using my microphone opened was, I do this impulse measurements, whether it's a balloon or using a sine sweep. And that impulse measurement I can use to take a recording done in one place and make it sound like it's a recording done in another place. It is being done by pop musicians, but when you do it as a research project, you know, as a way of comparing site one to site two, what is the difference between the two sites? They both sound good. Anupu is an extraordinarily good sounding space, so is Ranigumpa, but they are not same. They're very different. And they were built by different cultures at different times. Anupu is a Greco-Roman stadium built in the 3rd or 4th century AD. And Ranigumpa is probably 3rd century BC or 2nd century BC, Ashokan period. So, and it is carved out of stone. It's a single rock. Whereas Anupu was built out of bricks. This is typical Buddhist style. Build bricks and put a layer of stone on top. The layer of stone is mostly gone, but the acoustics have surprisingly survived. And surprisingly, of all the places I've been to, the Archaeological Survey of India noticed that it sounds interesting. It puts it in its field report. You know, they publish these extremely detailed field reports. The Nagarjanakonda field report actually mentions the acoustic properties of Anupu. The other reasons for thinking it's a theater, like there's a temple at the back, which a Greek theater would have had, because you went to the temple of Hecate and worshiped before you performed. So there are, but the thing is, the sound of Anupu and the sound of, I have now four places where I've done measurements. And the next stage would always be, how do I let people listen to these sounds? I can write a paper. That's easy enough. I can go to the Acoustic Society of America and produce 20 charts they will look at, and some of them will actually try and figure out what those charts mean. But that's not a satisfactory thing for me, because I am not actually a scientist. I'm only pretending. And I needed to actually create something out of these measurements. So now I've built one in Leipzig. I'll build another in Bangalore. A grid of 8 loudspeakers, about 30 centimeters, which you can wear on your shoulders. And in that space, I hope to recreate, you know, the sound spaces that I've measured, so that I can take a recording, which I've done in somebody's house, let's say, and you listen to that recording processed with what it would have sounded like if it was done in Anupu, what it would sound like if it was done in any of these sites. And I'm going to do one more site, hopefully, end of the year. And basically, the aim is to get this, and because I'm building equipment that's fairly low cost, I want to teach people to learn how to do these measurements. In fact, my second project has been to take groups when I do the measurements and teach them what I do. One group was School of Environment and Architecture in Bombay. I spent 5 days teaching them about basic acoustics. It's something that architects don't learn about. They have to find out about it afterwards, when they build an auditorium where nobody can sit. So they wanted me to come and spend 5 days. Basically, we measured our own workroom where we were doing the workshop, and they were very interested. So, and then we went to Karli Hills and did measurements in 2 or 3 of those caves, so that you get an idea of how these measurements are to be made. And surprisingly, they produced a report on what I taught them, and I was very impressed because they understood what I tried to do. And that doesn't happen to me always. And then we went to Ranigumpa again. I'd been there in 1996 first time. We went there again. They planted a lot of greenery, which changes the sound a bit, but because it is a dry, arid place. But the government wants to beautify it. I was worried that they would have done more, but they hadn't. They kept it, because it's really dangerous when Archaeological Survey decides to beautify a place. It is not their job, first thing. And anyway, I went with students from Assam and Calcutta and Delhi and Shimla, about 6 or 7 of us, and we spent 2 days doing Ranigumpa and several other caves, because it's a complex of caves. Ranigumpa is the most interesting, and it's probably the most developed. And here we used balloons, I have a lot of 360 degree videos and all. I didn't want to bring them, but I want to make. They are there on with IFA. IFA has complete copies of everything I've done, measurements, recordings, and once I build this 8 loudspeaker system, I want to bring it around and have people put it on their shoulders and listen to these spaces. That's better than my trying to talk about it.
So I'm going to talk about Black Hole, the piece I've made, which I showed last night. See, the idea, not the idea, the desire to make, strangely enough, as soon as I started working with the sheet, a lot of material that came up was material about science, about astrophysics, which I'm interested in a very casual, the way you're interested in things and you keep casually reading about them every now and then. However, as the process I work with also as a maker and as an actor is Grotowski's work, which actually lays a lot of emphasis on impulse and on association, rather than constructing consciously. The conscious construction happens later. So as the material kept pouring in with my basic, whatever I remembered of my school physics, I started researching on astrophysics, things I had learned, things I did not know. And as much as it was fascinating and interesting to read, to look at, the larger question started to come in as to what makes a play. How do I perform a formula or a law of thermodynamics? Or for that matter, what is a play? And for a while, it started to bother me because I started thinking, oh, is a play a narrative that you have a story which you sort of take on? If I'm speaking science, then is that a lecture? Is that not a performance? Where does a lecture become a performance or a performance sort of, you know, turn into a lecture? And for the first 2 years at least, I was very adamant that I don't want to get into any narrative. Because I thought, okay, yeah, narrative is what is like, it kind of chains you down and I don't want to get into it. And I had a version of the piece which I was showing a lot of friends. And interestingly, most of the times, whoever saw it was like generally pissed off because they thought, why should I listen to this? Why should I want to know about black holes? Why should I be interested in this? Why have you taken this topic? But to a lot of these questions, you say, well, you know, I wanted to take a topic. I could have taken a love story. I've taken this. But somehow I started thinking, if this question sits in the room, that means something is amiss. And as I continued working, initially, much to my horror, a lot of personal material started coming in. So how I work is I don't write. I simply keep reading stuff, like kind of feeding myself, and I keep getting on the floor and working. So you're generally hoping that something connected will come, and you basically keep waiting and making. So when this personal material started coming, which actually had no connection with the science that I'd been like slogging my ass off for all these months, they just seemed like two different worlds for many months. And I very strongly resisted this idea because I thought, okay, this is like drama. This is conventional storytelling, narrative, while what I am trying to make is something to do with science. But eventually I realized that actually the play lies the collaboration is a collaboration of these different contexts and how they come together, how they sit together. How do you perform the science and how do you perform a personal narrative without one taking over the other, without one interfering with the other, but at the same time sort of sitting next to each other? So a lot of, one of my biggest struggles with this piece was like, how do you find a language, which means actual language also, like the scientific language, the English in a scientific language is very different from conversational English, or what sort of Hindi will come into the piece? How do people in theater, because text is a very important part of my work, how does the text shift? How does the performing of a text shift? How does the body shift in those transformations? So after a while I started thinking that perhaps the way to find sort of a key to this is to start mixing the contexts, to perform a scientific thing or placing them in such a way that they start to interact with each other without my actually consciously making the connection. It's like if I have a table and if I put a cow next to it, then you sitting there start trying to make a connection. This is a terrible example, but what I mean is like associations, like you put things together, but the piece is happening in your head. I kept feeling it has to happen in your head. It is not happening on stage here. When I was structuring, I started feeling it can't be about a story. It cannot be only about the science. Then what is it about? So it's like I'm placing things together and you sitting there make your connections as per however you want to make them. In terms of the visual language of the piece, again, you know, the thing about the piece was that if it has to happen in your head, nothing should distract you too much. At the same time, it shouldn't bore you. So it can't be visually too evocative that, you know, you are sort of taken in by the visual or by the performance or by the narrative. And yet these things have to sort of be competently put together so that so that you're not bored. So in terms of the visual language of the piece, again, another thing which was interesting, which I worked with my light designer who's here, was how do we create this world which is not a representative of the worlds that I'm talking about, but more an abstraction of this space and a space away from here. Like finite time, finite space, and something which is not very specific, which doesn't have a context. And how do you return back? So ideas of here I am performing to you became an essential part of the piece. The piece starts becoming visually as well as in terms of its performing of some other place, other time. And it also keeps returning to this space, this time, this context, narrative, story, mother, daughter, things like that. For me, in terms of a collaboration, it's more a collaboration of contexts. The contexts which are very personal, everyday, lives in Bombay, lives in cities, and contexts which are to do with science, contexts possibly to do with philosophy or existential angst. So it is these contexts which meet or at least confront each other in some way or the other. I have two little clips which I'll show. I mean, you've seen the play already, but this is just to sort of give you an idea of the context, like, you know, how I sort of found the key to... Yes, please.
To cover 6,000 light years at 5% the speed of light, a helium particle will take 1,200,821 years. 6,000 light years at 5% the speed of light. A helium particle will take 1,200,821 years. To cover 6,000 light years at 5% the speed of light. A helium particle will take 1,200,821 years. A given mass m turns into a black hole. where its short shield radius equals 2mg over c square, where g is a gravitational constant and c is the speed of light. A given mass m turns into a black hole, where its short shield radius equals 2mg over c square, where g is a gravitational constant and c is the speed of light. To cover 6,000 light years at 5% the speed of light. A helium particle will take 1,228,121 years.
And now I want to show another clip which has sort of a narrative put together with a law of thermodynamics.
Hands, fingers, mouths, shoulder blades, bellies, hips, thighs, calves, soles, pushing, prodding, searching.
Sorry, it ends with the second law of thermodynamics, which is not in the in this clip. I didn't know that. Nothing. So actually, if you technically look at the piece. I mean, you can call it flaw or cleverness, whichever point you're standing from, that the, while the science in the piece is technically correct, the context of who is looking at it, who's talking about it, at what position in their lives are they talking about it, makes it more of a metaphor. So technically, I actually started out wanting to make a piece about astrophysics, and ended up making a piece which is more about existential ideas, where science becomes more of a metaphor and as a way of sort of guiding or understanding your, the condition, the human condition, which was not the original plan, but that's how it ended up. Yes. Is it done? Thank you.
I invite Justin McCarthy, the moderator for the session, and the panelists to come up on stage.
Which means my hands, my legs, my backache, everything enters the piece, both in terms of its language, both in terms of the text, both in terms of sound work. And I am very interested in the contemporary life, which actually begins from me, but hopefully in my piece doesn't sort of end with me. But in the world that that we or I am living in, because I have first-hand knowledge of that. In this particular piece, actually, it's not. I was actually interestingly enough, when I started work on the piece, a lot of my friends, a few of my friends, would look at it and start off giving some sort of a statement like, "Oh, but this is all written in the Gita. We already know this." Like, you know, the first law of thermodynamics, for example, or ideas like the, like I was quite struck by somebody who saw the entire piece in my house as part of a rehearsal and said, so you're talking about the black hole in your stomach.
And I said, no, I'm talking about the, didn't you understand it? Like, it's a, but then I started realizing that a lot of science, as we speak of, particularly when you bring it into a personal context, starts connecting with the lot of ideas, writings, imagery, which is there in a lot of spiritual writing. Especially like ideas of void, ideas of emptiness, expansion, something which is very tiny, which things begin from. But I strictly wanted to keep the peace in the scientific space. However, I found it interesting that, you know, particularly in India, if when we talk of death, when we talk of what happens after death, or we talk of loss, or especially mortal loss or grief, a lot of times the conversations start, irrespective of whether you are an, whether you believe or not, sort of move into spiritual practices, meditative practices. But I consciously wanted to keep that out of the piece. What happens? You might find a, you might want to connect with it as an audience, but I, as a maker, am not making that direct connection for you. What I am making a direct connection with is the situation. Like, for example, when a dying woman is talking about the first law of thermodynamics, which states energy can't be created, it cannot be destroyed, the sum total of energy in the universe is the same. Because she's dying, and she's not a physics teacher speaking in a classroom, its meaning can change. Your meaning making of it can change. So, from my perspective,
can I interrupt you there?
Yes.
So when you were talking about people saying, oh, we know that already, it's in such and such a text. So when someone says that to you, does that inspire you to sort of go further in your work so that you can explain to them, yes, it may be in the text, but it has larger resonances, which, like what you're talking about a woman actually faced with her own death and all. Does that help you, sort of spur you on to delving more into your work when someone is so smug about something?
It spurred me on more than anything into keeping it more scientific and human, rather than moving into something which speaks of a particular sort of a spiritual writing or ideas. Because what happens is, this can be, both can be looked at as metaphors for each other.
But yet, what the little I saw was very beautifully spiritual and a very sort of calm. And I was wondering, you're obviously in love with your subject. And do you see one sole aim in your work? Is it solely so that young architects can learn how to build better spaces? Or is it more connected to getting other people to experience these amazing sonic experiences? Or does it have a more historical connection?
The way it begins for me was merely satisfying questions asked by one art historian about one place. But the moment I went there, and I was not an acoustics person.
That
I
was in Odisha. The place in Odisha?
Huh?
That was the place in Odisha?
Yeah, the Rani Gumpa place. I went with Tom Alt, who is earlier married to Sharon Lovin. Makes the connections. Anyway, okay. I went there, and I was very soon not interested in proving that this is a theater. I was interested in the sound of that space, and how can I communicate that sound to others? It's more a question of, you know, this is what I said, when I can write a paper, and that paper will be accepted by the Acoustical Society, and it's sufficiently solid, but that is, I am not a scientist. I'm really interested in, I would like others to share the joy I got out of the place. And since then, I had been working on how I can capture the sound of this space. And then, of course, you know, your questions change as you go.
But now that you've captured the, I mean, you've learned somewhat how to capture the sound, do you envision maybe a sort of installation type space that people could enter so that they could experience it?
I have used my recordings at a couple of places where there are 40 loudspeakers. That's the kind of space you want. I am not interested in that. Because, you see, I am not interested in that. There is one place, for instance, in Bangalore where you could do it. But you have to go to the Srishti. It's not close by. And it's only in Bangalore. It's not there anywhere else. I want ultimately for people to be able to you know, I'm hoping that in another 2 weeks or so, I'll have a little cube made of carbon fiber tubes and a little loudspeaker that you can put on your shoulders and experience the ambisonics of these. And then I will create a program of all the measure. You know, the trick is to record without any reverberation and process them with the reverberation of these spaces. And so actually you can put on a recording and listen to it and change places instant. See, one of the things we
so
can't...
That's the Brahma microphone. That's
no, the Brahma microphone I use for measurements. This is a new thing I started in the last 3 months. I built one copy. I got a grant from Goethe-Institut to do it because these things cost money then, even when you make it really cheap. But I'm trying to keep it low cost, about $800 or something like that. That's not so bad. And then, you know, you provide it for people to listen to. And I would rather do, you know, I can say, if I want to set this room up for ambisonics, it'll take quite a lot of money and effort, and a lot of people are too busy with the
sound. Take out the time.
Yeah, and also the audience that comes will not actually concentrate on sound, they will concentrate on the speakers. There are so many speakers, they'll start counting them. Like, you know, it is not, I want to keep it totally transparent. And the Brahma mic has the purpose of making it low cost. I want a lot of students to be able, you know, I had somebody come in 2 weeks ago. They want to be able to buy or borrow, and I have no problem lending them, and go out and do some measurements and come back. And, you know, a lot of the people who come to me are musicians. So what do they do with it? It's basically, you know, what they want to play with it. They're signed by me because that's the sort of thing I would like. I'd like a lot of people to become more aware of the sound of these spaces.
So it's like an open, moving archive in a way, or showing other people how to archive sound in a way, perhaps.
This archive is peculiar. It's very small. You know, the files are very, very small compared to a music recording. A 1 hour music recording is about 2 GB of sound, whereas these are 25K, 30K, I can get all the measurements in. So it's a lot easier. But what you're archiving is a building without people in it. It's without the performance. You put the performance in. You have the measurements.
You're inviting the people who use your research to put the performance in. Whether an imaginary performance from the past or perhaps something now.
I would like them to use this space and say what would they like to perform in this space. It could be an old recording. See, after our oldest recordings are less than 100 years old. So the rest are all imagined.
No, I was thinking more of like your name, Mantravadi, what the acoustic effects of certain halls would be when people used to sing or chant or...
It's a misnomer because I'm actually an unbeliever, complete unbeliever. And I come from 3 generations of unbelievers. My grandfather actually broke his thread in public. So there's no question of rebellion even. It's too late. And I write poems, but I write them in a language that the family doesn't write in. My uncle is a very famous Telugu poet, so I write in English. Because you have to, you know, only small rebellions are allowed. Similarly, you know, when you do something like this, I used to work in a newspaper. I used to edit an arts page, and then I worked 30 years in this archives of ethnomusicology, and always, you know, when I joined the archives, Nazir Jerazba was the founder of the place. And for me, the interest was, how can you make this accessible? It is not enough to have a lot of recordings. How are these recordings? And huge issues with recordings in terms of permissions, in terms of playback situations. And of course, when digital came...
Yes, I tried about 30 years ago. Huh? I tried getting in there about 30 years ago.
Where, into ARC?
Yeah, they let me in, but it was difficult to access.
The difficulty has always been, you know, how do you provide the material? Digital has made it a lot easier. As I said, you know, I was just lucky that I was going to Los Angeles to buy equipment, and in London Airport, I bought a copy of Audio Magazine, which had a photograph of the PCM F1, the first available digital recorder. So it just happens like... So we were right from the beginning saying, we have to go digital, you know. It was an imperative for us. It's lower cost to have a digital archive than... We have tapes. We have about 10,000 hours of... for the spool tapes. But when you access it, it's all digital. And access becomes a lot easier. You don't have to go into a listening room. You can sit anywhere in the building and put on headphones and listen. Things have changed in the last 30 years. You came when?
I visited it literally 30 years ago, I think.
95 you came?
To the archives. Mm. More like 90, okay. 89 or 90, yeah.
So I wasn't there in that particular period. Small period, I wasn't there. Anyway, but the point is, it is whether I was working in the newspaper, you know, when I joined the paper, I was 21 years old. And the question I had when I was working there, who am I writing for? You know, I wrote good English. I insisted on writing good English. I would not write trash. And I wanted complexity. But when who will read this? You know, when I publish reviews, who is going to read these reviews? And I finally decided a person like me will read it. And that was a good enough answer for me when I was 21, 22.
Absolutely.
And in a way, it still is the answer for me. Who will listen to this material? The people must have the curiosity. They must want to. And then I'll, my job is to provide the access.
Okay, thank you. And from your scientific approach, I also noticed there was some science even in Madhuja's approach to her work. I was absolutely flabbergasted by the enormity of issues that Madhuja is interested in addressing, from architecture to science to sort of negative futuristic visions, and then the various media, from the Kali Ghat painting to trying to reproduce woodcut effects in drawings, and the many, many other strands that you talked about, and the fascinating images of Calcutta and the crazy gates and the seven wonders of the world. I'm wondering, how do you actually, in the final, I don't like to use the word product, in the outcome of your project, how do you plan to rope all of these, this eclecticity into a sort of whole that we can sort of behold and take in all at once? Or maybe that's not the goal.
In a way, a project has a like an end product, but when you are practicing and when you are trying to bring together so many thoughts and strands and arguments, I think what I'm thinking is that it doesn't, or what I've done before also, it doesn't have to be like in one project. It can also take up different forms, you know. It could be a video, it could be a piece of writing, it could be a short story, it could be a graphic novel, it could be a installation. So it does not have to be, since it involves a lot of hard work as well in terms of labor of time, you know. It does not have to be like a one finished product is what I'm beginning to think.
But at this current moment, do all of these various amazing things you showed us, do they exist in a semi-coherent form? Or
Yeah.
So what would that form? Could you describe that to us?
One is like a paper. The other is... What I practically try to do to make sense, I do have different interests in terms of, you know, the modes in which I could express myself, but that is not so much like it's just that my mind strays in different directions, as it were. So I have to give it some kind of a clarity of thought and to bring together different strands. One is to write, and you know, in that sense, in fact, write. Possibly write academic papers, then that some of the sense that then it you're forced, you know, you get a review, the reviewer is asking you what I would say silly questions, and that forces to make some meaning. Then also you finish, let's say, the doc star in a particular way, but I'm still working on the different other forms of the projects on the city. So then it becomes a long-drawn project, maybe 5 years of different kinds of things and modes of expression that I'm interested in. So, currently I'm also doing a map project. So those
on the city of Kolkata.
Yes. So, and some of it is also, I think, everything doesn't, I feel, have to go out there. Some of the things are also for...
That's a very nice thought.
Yeah.
creative people, I think.
Yeah, yourself. So, yeah, some of it maybe will just be with
stay with you for a while and then maybe come out in some other form at another point.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, thank you. And Barun, again, I think there's a scientific strand everywhere, certainly with your work. And I really enjoyed you trying to juxtapose the modern female doctor with the traditional midwife. And you didn't seem to pass any judgment on either, saying that one was better than the other. You didn't valorize or demonize either of them. And I love the eclectic nature of the material you're using and the validation of, for lack of a better word, folk sources or non-official authoritative sources. But the question that really intrigued me while I listened to you was, in the end, how do you visualize the interaction between your book and the reader? I'm trying to imagine, how will the reader approach it in a gallery space and stand there and look at it slowly, or will they take it somewhere in a private space and read it like one curls up and reads a novel? Could you talk about that, please?
Yeah, that's what I should have spoken there. But I was suffering from indecision. So it's better to show this. Can you hold it?
Yes. Yeah.
So, no. I have to, So, I worked with Sanjayan Ghosh of Vishwabharati, and he contributed a lot. So let's say, I narrated a story of a Dai who uses some mantra, some chants, and that voodoo needle.
The one you showed at the end, in the last year, showed. Okay.
So I asked Sanjayan to incorporate this in a single space, as we are referring to.
Sorry, can I interrupt? Is there a name for that voodoo needle in Bengali? What is it called?
It is ban.
Ah, ban, you said.
And the process is called maron uchaton. Generally inflicting evil things. But the Dais believe in a different way. They inflict
with a beneficial,
good,
with a beneficial
aspects. Beneficial aspects. So Sanjayan asked me, should I do something like a pelvic girdle, which will be opened, and you can put the ban there. And it's called chachari. The native Dais use a piece of bamboo which can cut the umbilical cord. So I don't want to show these as illustrations. I tried my best to put the materials and the real objects, since they're small enough, and it can be incorporated in a modified kind of file so that when my reader, I won't direct him or her to go through a particular sequence. It's up to her. There will be three or four stages. There will be three or four diaries, some leaves. Say the barn is here, the chachari is here, a mirror is here, some strands of threads are here, some roots of particular trees are there. So when a reader opens the file, go through the materials and close it, he or she will have the basic essence of my narrative. Okay. That's the Confluence's form. So if I contribute 50%, then Sanjayan contributed 50% also. And finally, we are doing things together. We cannot stay separate. Like the materials can't stay separate.
No.
The narrative can't afford to be separated from the material. So, and fortunately, mainly because of Sanchan's pedagogic skill and his control over materials, he has found a way to put all these things together without making it very complicated to handle.
So in the basic bourgeois sense, in the final stage, will someone be able to possess it in their own home, or do you envision it more in an exhibition type space? Or
it can be a very limited edition kind of book. But now I think actually, I have. It's a process of my own development.
So you haven't thought that.
Now I think it can be an exhibition. If you enter from one door and roam through it, you will get your version of the story. And one thing you pointed out very correctly, we cannot ascribe any value to the practitioners of medicine educated in medical colleges and the traditional. Both are terribly educated. Both are terribly equipped. Both have served the people. So like Hoti Vidyalankar, she had 1,000 recipes, literally. And one of those recipes was Shona Jaru. It's the ashes of gold. And one European, he's Dutch, he got it from one of her disciples. And a particular tonic was made from her recipe. It was manufactured in Germany and exported to India.
Okay, so thank you, all of you, for bearing with my questions. And now I think we'd like to ask you to further forbearance and have questions from the audience also. So if you people would like to ask any questions.
From what we've heard about the practice of all these four people, we can understand why the idea of confluence of forms is interesting. But I want to look at it from a slightly different angle, and I want to go back to the story that Justin told at the beginning, which was about telling T.M. Krishna, why don't you just sing instead of doing politics or talking about politics? My answer would be not just that it's about curiosity, but that he should talk about politics precisely because he's a musician. Because being a musician may, not always, but may give him a perspective which someone in the discipline he's talking about may not have, or someone from another position may not have. So what is interesting in some of the things that I've heard is that they are coming to a discipline, say like science, or like, you know, sounds in temples, from a particular position. And my question to them is that from the position they came from, did that actually lead to a new perspective, a new discovery, new knowledge, new creativity?
Would one of you like to answer that question?
I will answer it negatively, because when I worked in the newspaper, I had Mrs. Gandhi on my back. And then I came to Delhi, and of course Delhi, everything is on your back when I worked in the archives of music. And music in India is almost always ritual based on belief. And here was this unbeliever who was trying very hard to keep his unbelief at the center of his mind while, you know, listening to the Agni Chayana recorded by Stahl, or you listen to a lot of material, and one of the things you learn is to separate the performer's own belief from your listening. You know, and actually you learn to appreciate the performer's beliefs much more when you see how hard they work at it. You know, the fact that I don't believe in what the priest doing Agni Chayana doesn't mean anything. So, and when I got into measurement of spaces, you know, the first one was fairly okay. Yes, I wanted it to be Jain and I wanted it to be Buddhist. Simple argument. But when you come to temples, and I had been concerned right from the beginning. In fact, I didn't go to Hampi beginning of this year because there's a lot of trouble going on there. And this is going to be always at the back of my mind. Am I promoting ideologies I do not like by doing these measurements? And it's a question I have to ask myself, and I do ask myself, and I keep hoping that it doesn't matter. I am interested.
That is a very important question. Every day as a Bharatanatyam dancer, I wake up in the morning and I question, am I actually promoting a certain ideology which I do not agree with just by being a Bharatanatyam dancer? It's a very difficult question to grapple with.
It's a good question. It has to be asked by anybody
who has, you know, the performer himself, very often I find is too involved in the performance to ask the question. But those who are on the periphery of the, I'm not talking the audience, I'm talking the, those who are on the periphery, you know, they have a responsibility to know what's happening.
I just to respond to his the question that came up, that in a way, when you are trained, let's say, in a particular discipline, it has its own advantages. But then I presume we all come from the different stages, you know, and it might appear that when I start the graphic novel at that point, I'm also a filmmaker or, you know, a film studies professor, whatever. But there is also a prehistory to how I've arrived to that point. So in that way, you're already, you know, there are various strands that are coming together to this condition. And I think, yes, in the sense that it allows you obviously a different perspective, in the sense that you have a training. However, when you start, let's say specifically, like Jyoti was talking about her performance, or if I have to really sketch whatever, a dog, a house, a tree, I have to do it. You know, it's at that point I have to. It's also it requires a different kind of labor. So then you are forced to, or if even if you're making a film, it has to be in a certain order. It has to be visible. It has to sound, has to be audible if you're recording. So then that forces you into a different terrain altogether. You know, so then the parameters of another practice, you have to negotiate, you have to handle, you have to deal with. I think but what is interesting while listening to the other panelists, that when I started working, you know, everybody, I wasn't sure, like, do I really have to do this? No, or where am I heading? What will come out of this? But it is so interesting to see now that so many people are thinking in terms of, like Maruna was saying, that he isn't, you know, it's a process. You think that you want to make a book, then you think you want an installation. Maybe you, I was thinking, you know, especially the sound, that it can, there is possibility of a collaboration. So there are, I think it's, what is nice is that we are at this moment looking at a specific juncture, but it is a journey. And these forms allow us to take that journey is something that is so incredible, because it's not like a journey way of saying, because it's incredibly hard work as well, because sometimes things don't, like I was speaking to Gitanjali earlier, like, okay, you do it, then it is printed, then the black is not black, you know, so there are so many things, technical things to it also. So in that sense, it's a interesting synergy. Pallavi.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this panel. Thank you everyone who brought their works and spoke about them so eloquently. My question actually starts, it's a question for Madhuja and Jyoti primarily. And I was very interested, Jyoti, in what you said in your presentation, that you, to the question by the moderator, that you wanted the science to feel kind of wrong, even though it's technically, I mean, you wanted not the science, but the feeling that we're hearing something from a scientific context, in a context where it doesn't belong. And it made me think also about the inverse, because this question of the personal and the experience as the primary site of the production of anything, of any artistic gesture, sometimes I feel like, increasingly I feel that the trouble with it is also that if it is not my experience, then I can say nothing about it, you know? And I feel that also kind of keeps people out of so many things that are possible and you know? So I feel, the question is very simple actually, that would you also imagine doing that with the personal? like kind of bringing the personal to a space where it feels kind of wrong or it doesn't belong, you know? So while like you're coming at it from the scientific side where you're placing something from science in a context to actually create a feeling of unhomeliness, you know, for that material, would you consider or would you imagine a scenario where a performer who is actually using so much material from the personal would also consider doing that to personal material, kind of make it unhomely in a performative context while actually addressing it? That's one question. And to Madhuja, my question is also kind of connected and similar, is like, of course, I've had the privilege of engaging with your work now for a while and I've kind of known you also personally. My question is that, and also like we're constantly, you know, having this conversation about what do you do with the work of other artists like Barun, and in my case, I'm looking at Vidrohi. And the thing is that sometimes it's also perhaps important, I feel sometimes it's also important to be irreverent to the material that you're kind of looking at. So in that sense, my question is that when one is thinking about adaptation and kind of you had this really fun story about the women not flying and then in your novel, they are flying. It's kind of what do you do when you are working with another artist whose work kind of finds itself enmeshed with yours, but how do you stage a collision which is productive and not just kind of get entrapped in the burden of faithfulness?
To begin with, when you, I personally feel, because I work a lot with the self, I always start with the self. And a very essential part for me of using personal material, first of all, is that scene, like in the lovemaking, she is describing it to you. In the dying of the mother, she's describing something to you. So also in terms of when I was trying to find a performance language, because one is you are, as an actor, you are in it and you are experiencing it, and through me, you are experiencing it. But here the thing was that I am experiencing it, but I am commenting on it simultaneously, which then becomes, not very wrong, but from a very performative, sort of an actorly point of view, it's like when you are performing it, internalizing it, why do you have to make an observation, like a scientific observation of it? Not just the notation, even the text, how the text is put together, how the text is performed, but how the text is also written. It's more like observational idea. It is observations, which sort of makes it... like in this particular piece, one of the things I tried was I did not want to perform a character. Who's this woman? Does she work? Does she not work? How old is she? Is she married to this man? All these ideas which sort of make, situate her in a specific space and time were sort of thrown out so that these sort of groundedness or the rootedness does not come in. So.
Okay, thank you. In the interest of scientific measurement of time, we're going to have to... Because we have to...
I'll just quickly, you know, because I really think it's a very important question for me because of the, given the kind of aura that Barun has and when you're dealing with it. So when I first tried, I was thinking in terms of that, how will this be received? But when Kangal Malshat, the graphic version that I did was so dense that following that, it was like a release, like a catharsis as it were. And now for me, I am working on it as in a way that I would interpret it. That it is my reading of how, in a way, the Dog Star, so his political discourse, it is my reading, my interpretation, and I am trying to find appropriate ways in which I can imagine, connected it to the larger sort of styles within which artists have worked. So it has really become, in that sense, my imagination and that faithfulness. It is in that sense, there is a narrative structure, but it is not faithful as far as the narrative is concerned, because I've picked up snippets like a line and made a page out of it, a word and made a page out of it. So I've worked like that instead of trying to be faithful. But that burden was there earlier. Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you once more to all of the
Thanks to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Arunma.
Thank you so much for this panel. Jyoti, Uma, Madhuja, Barun, and Justin, thanks for holding this together.